Welcome to the latest episode of the Informing Choices Minipod. Extended reality, or XR, is a term used to collectively describe immersive technologies, virtual reality, augmented reality, and mixed reality. These technologies extend reality by adding to or simulating the real world through digital materials. Virtual reality creates a simulated environment where participants can complete realistic interactions with objects and people. Augmented reality adds interactive digital elements to a live, real-world environment through a digital device. And mixed reality uses advanced computer technology, graphics, and input systems to blend physical and digital worlds. With the extended reality revolution already underway, it's easy to envision a future in which the lines between the real world and virtual world become ever more blurred than they are today. To discuss the possibilities presented by extended reality technologies, co-founder of Shooting Stories, a video marketing and digital media production company, and technology director at IORMA, Ross Edwards joins me on the podcast. Ross, welcome to Informing Choices Minipod. Tell us a little bit about you and your work.
Good morning. Yes, thank you for having me on. My background is was from photography, then moving on to sort of digital filmmaking, and then digital environments. We're working on sort of special effects for feature films and such like. Then as soon as I came across virtual reality, I suddenly realized there's an amazing space to be working in, amazingly powerful.
That's brilliant. So what do you think are the key technological advances coming our way in virtual reality and augmented reality? You know, what are the critical changes we're going to see into the future?
I think it's very similar to sort of the trajectory that sort of mobile phones had. It changes a lot because of the faster the speeds of the computers, the smaller we can make components, the more comfortable headsets become. I think it'll be, which will add all add on to the sort of like the pickup and people's use of the medium of VR. And with AR, obviously, it's already out there. The medium's actually, so with the smartphone, it can be used already. I think some of the exciting things coming up will be sort of haptics. So the sense of touch within VR, this being able to smell and sense maybe heat. If you walk into a room in VR, you can actually feel the sunlight on the side of your face. And that all adds to the immersive experience that you can have. And I think because of the use of peripheral vision, once you're in VR, so many more of your senses are in use, and your body feels so much more natural to be in that space. So I think those are the really interesting ones and how we start to use that. The other one is multi-user. I think a lot of people think of VR as a gaming sort of, as an extension of a PlayStation or something like this, but it is so much more. And especially for when you meet other people inside VR, as I said, about the peripheral vision, you're using so many more of your senses to how we read body movements and things, even if it's an avatar, that the feedback you get is so much different. And it's so much more relaxing than doing two by screens. I think it allows us to for our bodies to relax more. And a lot less tiring than traditional ways.
And I guess that's one of the things that many of us have found over the last 12, 18, it will probably be beyond 24 months through the COVID pandemic, with Zoom fatigue, Teams fatigue, Skype fatigue, whatever fatigue it is. But it's a very two-dimensional world we're interacting through at the moment, isn't it?
Yes, certainly. And there's been some papers out already about the fatigue of Zoom fatigue, about doing things in two dimensions. I've had experiences where I've had one-to-ones with people and our avatars have not been very realistic. If you look at it from an outside thing, it's not realistic at all. But the experience you have is a very human experience of interacting with people, because their body or their avatars move, and your senses, it's just so much more relaxing and personal. And it's really hard to describe. It's one of the things, if you look at from the outside, it's really hard to understand. It's like describing a taste of a wine. Wine tasting is not done very well over Zoom. You really need to taste the wine. And VR is exactly the same as that. You've got to be inside it to actually really understand the power and the potential of it for so many different aspects, from health, sort of mental health, well-being, educational spaces, spaces to feel safe in, spaces to communicate with. And it just allows communication, you know, sort of worldwide as well. And also the educational side of things. If with the improvement of 5G and stuff and being wireless, this means you can have the best teachers in the world, and you can be in their class learning directly from them. And they're already doing this with surgeons in operating theatre. Normally they can only take one or two students in with them to be able to see what they're doing. But with VR, if you're doing volumetric filming, which means you can go around every bit of it as well, you can have the best surgeons. And that means we can have the best, the students learning from the best surgeons. And you can have endless thousands of students really working from that. So for best practice and things, you can really, really learn a lot.
So you started to touch on some things there that I was going to ask next, which is, you know, what are the kind of everyday life applications for these technologies? You started to talk about one there, about the environment in learning at surgery. But, you know, what are the other real life applications we might imagine in the future would be enhanced through these technologies?
I'm saying is teams have just announced that next year they're releasing avatars. So teams will be in VR. You'll be able to do team meetings in VR. So, you know, whatever working groups you're in, you can actually be in VR and sort of be able to meet up there. And the nice thing about meeting up in VR is that you can actually walk away. The sound works exactly how it does in the real world. So if there's a group of people over there, you can hear them, but then you go closer to them and you can join their conversations. You can move away, start different conversations. I mean, this is close, obviously, as close as you can get to a real life meeting. And this just adds up to you communicating. Maybe it's for families, it's, you know, sort of maybe it's families meeting, maybe it's different groups meeting, maybe it's a hobby. You know, there's so much potential for this. And once it's in VR, your hobbyists can meet up. If you're model makers, you might be able to display a model within VR and be able to go around it and discuss it things. And one could be in Argentina, someone else could be in Australia, and one could be in Britain. So hobbies could be sort of a major thing as well. And there's one aspect I was using actually over the weekend, is like the IKEA app for AR, where you can actually place bits of furniture in your room. We're sorting out a property at the moment, and we're looking at different size sofas to be able to fit in there. And the fact that you can overlay it, look through your smartphone and overlay where that sofa will actually fit in, and also color-wise as well. This sounds a bit trivial, but it's obviously important if you're trying to match things up. The things like the iPhone screen is very good for color renditions, you know, surprisingly so. The film industry was surprised how accurate the screens on iPhones actually are. So if you're talking about that, then you're talking about matching up materials and things like this to whatever's in your home. You're standing it, you're holding it side by side. It means that, you know, so making those sort of decisions can be a lot more, you can be a lot more secure in making these sort of decisions. And the other last thing is Walmart. They've been using another thing for Walmart, have been using VR for training there. They bought 70,000 headsets or something, some ridiculous number, where they're training their staff. So they were getting used to sort of like Black Friday. If there's a rush of customers coming in,
right,
the psychological effect of how you deal with that. You can do it in, yeah, on 2D screen, but that's nothing compared to when you've got different people coming from different directions at you as well. So to have the skill set to learn that or go through that and give you some idea of it, it's a lot cheaper for them to invest in VR rather than in maybe hire
150,000 extras
at every store to recreate what Black Friday might entail. So we will come across it. I think VR and AR in so many different training, when you're in different jobs you're doing, just helping you train on site. And it's also like having someone stand over your shoulder. One of the biggest problems at the moment is when you have someone on work experience, or you have a new job, someone joining your work, is you lose another person half their time because they're standing over the person's shoulders guiding them. Now, if you can dedicate that to AR or VR, then you're actually freeing up your own staff to do that. And then you're holding someone's hand a lot longer through the process of learning and training, and which would be better for all round. It's a totally win-win situation.
It sounds like from a business perspective that's ticking both the effectiveness and the efficiency boxes, isn't it?
Yes, and I think it's better for the person coming on board. The onboarding process will be so much smoother, and I think it's an all-round winner, I think.
But I know I said at the beginning and during the introduction that the extended reality revolution was already underway, but it felt like it's already been underway for a number of years. So with this family of technologies having been around for actually such a long time already, what are the critical enablers that will continue to drive their development and their adoption?
Yes, and I totally understand this, and it has been around for a long time. I think I got photographs of a VR set being used in 1952 when the American Air Force started using it, and it was pretty big and clunky then. And it is purely a time thing. With if you look at Moore's Law, the power of the computational computers, and then sort of the ergonomics of design. And the nice thing about it is we're getting one of the most popular headsets at the moment, like the Oculus 2. The software updates on that are phenomenal. We're used to upgrades our computers where we don't really see much difference. It's a little upgrade or whatever. But they do upgrades and they send them out, and you're getting massive boosts. It's going for a time where we're seeing massive increases in speed and performance, and getting the frame rate down is one of the biggest things in VR. You know, general frame rates for films are 24 frames a second, for games up to 60 seconds, but generally it's been 90 seconds for 90 frames per second for smooth VR. And that's quite hard for computationally to generate that many if you're doing 360 sort of environments and things. But now they're coming down. They've almost halved that. They found a software way of doing halving that. So we're massive improvements. And also things like the making the headsets more comfortable, slipping and a lot lighter, and people getting used to it. And also getting over a wow factor as well. I think any with new technology, people have a wow factor where you could put almost anything in, and people, you just generally put a like a roller coaster ride and everyone goes, well, the first experience of VR and things like this. But when it becomes really interesting is when you start getting applications which actually have substance to them. Yeah. And I think it's no difference to the internet and say mobile phones. The trajectory of this as a medium, you know, people start finding out actual uses for this. And I think what's really interesting is when AI, we start using that. So you get responsive data and we get live data coming in. And we'd be able to translate live data usage. So if you've got like air pollution, you've got AR looking through your phone, you might be able to see where that is. We've been working on some things with sound. You've seen me see sound waves and how they work and things. And overlaying live data on AR is a really great thing. I think it'd be amazing. And also in VR, we're working on a project with the schools and stuff where you're actually getting feedback. There's some quite good VR stuff out for schools, but they tend to be like quite a good experience, but the teachers don't know what the children are actually learning from it. So we need to find ways where we can actually sort of be in the VR, and we find out what the children are learning and what they're taking on. So we're coming up with ways of doing that and making it so the teachers can say, okay, so Bobby learned this out of this and just remembered this because he's demonstrated this. So that kind of responsive AR applications VR I think is going to be massive.
One of the things that's particularly struck me, and you used the word earlier on, and I guess it's the one thing that people worry about when we start to talk about the growth of technology, and that's ensuring that technology helps us to humanize things that maybe machines take away from us. And it sounds to me from a couple of things that you've said there that actually that's a really critical element that will help the adoption of these technologies going forward as well.
Yes, I think it is. It's breaking through that the 2D screen. It's getting, realizing that and making the most out of that. And people are using it to say for health purposes as well, you know. So like it's a great thing. People from burns victims, if you create a nice scenario in VR, it allows their body temperature to drop, so it means they use less painkillers, used for phantom limbs. A lot of it's for phobias, whether it's elevators or spiders and things like this. But there's a real human factor to this. Yeah, we'll be coming to play.
Well, Ross, that was a very quick tour through a very exciting technology area. So thank you ever so much for your time. Tell us, how can people connect with you, contact you to learn more about what you do?
All right. Yes. No, if you'd like to catch my email, it's ross.edwards@iorma.com. So yeah, I'd love to hear from anyone and speak to about different projects. I say we're working on different projects, one from Carmen Music and one for educational purposes as well. So we'd love to speak to anyone.
Sounds absolutely fascinating. Ross, thanks ever so much for your time once again.
That's a pleasure. Thank you very much, Steve.
And thank you everyone for listening. Do let your friends and colleagues know about the Informing Choices mini pod, and I'll see you on another episode very soon.